Hey class, today we're going to unbox the ATEM 1ME Production Studio 4K. It's a mouthful, and we're going to open it up in this episode of Mr. Jamie on Campus.
All right, well, I'm really excited. We finally get to unbox the mixer that we're going to use to mix video and our new system. It's the ATEM 1ME Production Studio 4K. We decided we wanted at least the one effects, mix effects engine. But then, of course, we like the idea of it having 6G SDI input, so it's 4K ready. The cameras that we're interested in are 4K capable as well. So I'm trying to get as much 4K equipment in this initial version of our system, just so that it's not a big expense when it's time to move up to that next level. Anyway, let's get this open. I've already used Papaw's knife and opened the plastic. So very consistent packaging. And as we've seen before, we've got this this advertisement and then the software and manual come on an SD card. And I'm sure we're going to need that, so I'll set that aside right here. And here we go. Ah, very nice. Strange though, this rack ear is bent. First look, we don't have any damage to the carton. But that rack ear, can you see it? That one right there is bent in. I'll put it in the, if that's all that's wrong, I see no point in sending it back for that. Now, it does indicate at some point there may have been in the factory an impact. So we're going to really check it out and make sure that it's working before I say that everything is just fine. There's a little bit of stress, I don't know if you can see. There, it's in focus finally, where it's taking an impact. So, all right, let me take you on a little tour of what I see. We have 10 numbered buttons, a blank, a black button, and then 12 function buttons, and then 1, 2, and 3. So I'm anxious to see what that is. Here's a display screen. I'm assuming it shows program out, but it probably is multifunction based on what I have seen about Blackmagic. Now, the back, we have the connector for power, and incidentally, they don't send the power cable, which is just fine for most of us, because I don't know about you, but I've got dozens of them. But if it's a brand new first studio for you and this is your first purchase, just know you need to hold back one of those cables that came with an old computer or a monitor or practically anything that uses the 3-pin power, because you're going to need to get one for this because they don't send it. We have Ethernet control, USB 2.0, is like a printer cable, will go into there, the larger USB, and then we're getting into the inputs here. We have our input 1 has an HDMI or SDI, and that's the only HDMI input that we have. That's there for our convenience, and I'm thankful for that. The rest of the 10 inputs are all SDI, 6G SDI inputs, and then we have a reference in for Blackburst or whatever the you're using for synchronization. And then we have three auxiliaries. Very nice feature. They're auxiliary outs. And what we, I think I'm going to use them for, we'll see once we get it in, is I want the person that's sitting at this position to have, if they're the only one operating this room, which sometimes is the case, then we can send what goes to the center projector screen or the side projector screens out on either side of the stage. They can, we can have the sides on one auxiliary, the center perhaps on the other, and then the third one might even be the CCTV feed that goes out to all of our hallways and other classrooms and things like that. That way one person at one position can send those, which I think is going to be a nice feature to have. Now, once we get in there, we'll find out if that's possible. But now there's a preview output, and then we have program outs, and there are lots of options here. It looks like we have four options. There are three SDI ones. It says 1, 2, and then an HD. Perhaps this HD is the typical maybe 3G HD or even less. I don't know. I'll find out what the specs say, but there are three of those. And then we have an HDMI output, which I'm very thankful for, again, because that's going to save me an HDI converter box, at least one, for one of my sources that has, or I guess one of my destinations that takes HDMI. So that's nice. We've got remote. It's a 9-pin DIN remote. And then you've got the multi-view out, which for us is such a nice thing. I know some of you probably are saying, what, that's everything has it. Well, that might be true, but see, we're replacing a system that all I had was, this is what my preview monitor, and that is my program monitor. And then I had some 4-inch black and white previews for each of the cameras. And so they would set them up, set up their shot in black and white, put it on preview, make sure it's right, send it to program. It's now we're going to get, by looking at just this one screen, we're going to have everything, and I'm so glad about that. I'm so thankful for that. And there's an HD output for that too, which is nice, because that's, I'll actually use it for this monitor so that we don't have to spend a converter box on there. And then analog audio, which is a great thing, because we have behind the camera here is a audio position for broadcast sound, and I have a student that runs audio just for the broadcast. And so there's an output here. There's an output we'll probably use for for recording and CCTV, and because we want that mix, we want to take whatever we're getting from the cameras and potentially use it in the mix, but we want to have final say at the board what our audio is going to be like, and then bring it back in probably to this into this analog input, this XLR input. Actually, check that. These RCA jacks are stereo input. So we've got audio in RCA form, audio in the form of channel 1 and 2 XLR, and then we've got a single stereo XLR output as well. So my thoughts on how we're going to implement this is whether or not we use this input, I'm not sure. We possibly could. The output, though, will absolutely have... Yeah, we'll use the input. Of course we'll use the input, because we'll have to take our mix from here, from this station, and send it in to override the final mix of everything. And then this output will probably send that up to our house mix for when we have video that we're playing or anything like that, so that the embedded SDI audio that goes with the video that we're playing out of whatever source gets sent to our house mix. I believe that's how it's going to work. We'll see. I'm speculating at this point because I haven't gotten in there yet. Well, up next is the installation. And one thing before I start, I need you to understand that we've changed one thing, kind of a big deal, since I installed the SmartScope Duo in the small little black portable rack that had the little mixer in the top. I've scrapped that idea because there's just not enough space in that little rack for everything that we need to have a legitimate portable system. So for now, we are not going to have an easily transportable portable video system, and that's going to be okay for now. what I've done, because I don't want to spend money, any more money, we've taken the old wooden rack that we were using, and I've taken the old rails out, because they were actually just angle iron that somebody had cut and installed, and every time they needed to tap that to put a piece of equipment in, that they would put the equipment where they wanted it, mark the holes, drill through the angle, thread the angle, and then install it. So it's not a consistent rail as far as the threaded holes. They weren't consistent, and they were very few actual holes. So I ordered replacement rails and installed them, added a couple pieces of wood at the top and the bottom to tighten everything up, restain the whole thing. While it may not be absolutely perfect, I'm very pleased with it, and I think it looks great in the room. And so that is the wooden rack that you're going to see me install this in. So that's a change. Just want to let you know so you aren't confused. Let's install this thing. All right, so everyone knows that the only thing you need to install something in a rack is 4 rack screws and a lightsaber screwdriver. Let's do this. You know, I don't know how you guys do it. These things are always such a pain. What I tend to do is, on these 1U units that are fairly easy to hold by hand, I'll go ahead and start them all holding it with one hand. These are new rails, and the first time these screws have gone through, so. Then I do the bottom. I don't like the way this is looking. It's sitting out from the rack probably a quarter inch because of that bend. I don't want to be particular, but we did spend a bunch of money on it. Okay. It's a solid piece of metal. There's no bending it back this way. If everything checks out, then what I'm going to try to do is just take it out and put it on the table and use my weight to try to, if it bends back fairly easy, then great. If not, then we'll just send it back. But let's not get sidetracked. Having a hard time putting this out of my mind. All right, I got to give it power. So I'm going to roll the rack out. Now, I didn't have the ability to roll the rack easily out in my last setup because all the cabling was too short. It was just a big mess. All the cables, too. It was an old system, so all the cables were that big, and it was just so heavy. I made sure during this installation that everything I've done has lots of extra length of cable so I can roll the rack out and have easy access to everything. Suppose the first thing I need to do, of course, is apply power. I got to get a power cord off the wall. We've got a wall of cables. And get a power cord off the wall and plug it in. Then I'm going to hook up my preview and program outs using a temporary HDMI line to these two screens. And that will get us where we can actually see what's coming out of the system. And then I'll find a couple of inputs and hook them up from our router, and then we can play around with it and see what we got. I don't have cameras yet, so some of this might be a little difficult, but we'll be able to see if, for example, we have TV cable coming in. I'll take that feed as one of our inputs, and I've got a GoPro. I think I got the right cable for it, and we'll try that on the HDMI input and see what we can do. All right, I'll be right back. All right, guys, so I've got it installed. I want to first show you that I had thought through the signal flow a little bit, and so I've made a spreadsheet on Apple Numbers that has a listing of all 20 inputs and 20 outputs of my router. the 20 by 20 router that we've already had a video on and installed. And so so I could know where my in and outs are for the router and also for the switcher. So it's so the choices I made about which channel and so forth were based on this. And it took me a couple of days of thinking off and on. So there's a method to the madness. At least I hope so. But if after we get through with this process, you have some suggestions about how I should have done it, I definitely want to hear them. You do that in the comments, okay? Or send an email, and maybe we can discuss it. If you send an email to Jamie at mrjamie.com, then in the viewer mail segment, maybe we'll read your email and then talk about why I made the decision not to, or implement your suggestion. Very well might do that. You know, I like to learn from other people's experience. I think that makes me a better teacher, and it makes me just a better practitioner of the skill that I'm doing. In this case, videography. I want to learn and take the advice of others, because the only reason you'll think I'm really foolish is if I ignore good counsel. So, okay, back to this. I'm going to turn the camera a bit. All right, so here's what I've got set up so far, and I have not turned it on. I don't know if this is going to work or not, so check me here. On my router, I have set up router channel 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, and 18, the outputs of the router, to the inputs 5 through 10 on the ATEM switcher. And here's my reasoning. I want to leave 1, 2, 3, and 4 on the ATEM open for cameras 1, 2, 3, and 4, and I'm not going to require that those go through my router. They can, but I'm not going to say that they have to go there first. And the reason is because for those four cameras, we've run fiber to connect between them, and I do not want to convert every one of them from SD to fiber. I'm instead going to get the TalkBack converter. It's a Blackmagic design product, and we've priced it in with our cameras. So when I get the four cameras, or at least the first couple, I'm also going to have the TalkBack converter, which is a box that will take all of our camera inputs as dual fiber lines, so it handles both intercom to and from the camera as well as the video feed over fiber. And we've got the fiber lines run. In fact, these yellow cables here, I've run four fiber lines from the position where the three cameras are going to be in our sound booth, which is up high on the opposite end of the room, and then we'll have one camera, probably camera four in my numbering, that will be our moving camera. And I don't want to have weak fiber lines there. I don't want to spend the money for the really durable fiber. So I've got a spool of really high grade SDI cable for digital that will cut and terminate a line, or two lines actually, just for that moving camera four, and that'll run separately. So I'm reserving four those four cameras out of the ATEM switcher. But for today, I did take the HDMI output of this GoPro, and I haven't used this in forever. It's got a little LCD screen on the back. Yeah, and so according to the LCD screen, it's working. The HDMI output's coming out of it. It's a Hero 2, so it's a little bit older, but it does have the HDMI output. And so, and I've got that run into the HDMI input in channel 1 of the ATEM switcher that I was so happy that they gave us. So we're going to get to try out the HDMI input as well. Now, that's the only inputs I've set up. So from my router, I have, again, from 13 to 18, 13, 14, that's two, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, and 18, those outputs from the router go into channels 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10 of the ATEM switcher. So we should see those when we turn it on. Let's hope. Right. So I'm going to turn the rack around, put it into place, flip the power on, and I'm actually going to change shots. So I'm going to cut it here, and I'll move this into place, and then I will turn you the camera back on before I push the power button on the rack. So we'll see if we got it in the first try. Hope. Guys, sorry it's so close. It's a tight fit in this little spot that I'm in. I've got it installed, ready to turn the power on. Let's hope this is not an embarrassing moment. Power is up here. And we'll bring it to life. Okay, got our screen. I have it set. Okay, smart video hub. Color bars here. And color bars is selected, so that's helpful. Okay, so let's look at the routing so far. Right now we've got this screen is showing bars. We've got preview option and program option. Before I mess with this any, I want to see what we've got hooked up and what's routed to channels 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. All right, well first, let me look at that. Let's see what... Okay, I'm just going to hit 5 here. And then through my router, I'd like to do a couple of things. First, I want to route let's route the program feed to this monitor. Let's just see. Now, in my router, let me look across here. Got my laptop here, my guide. I show that the program input of the router is channel 7, which means that if I want to see what's on program, then my source needs to be 7. However, my destination is going to be 2, because that's this screen. Right now, if I click destination and look at 2, it's showing that input 5 is the destination, but input 5 is the computer that's not turned on. I can verify that this is working by changing my source to this cable, which I think, first let me check, the destination of 1 is input 11, which is cable TV. So if I go to destination 2 and change it to 11, and I preview it, I see that that's 11, that's the TV. If I hit take, then it puts it here. Okay, so I don't want the television program here. I want this output here. So I'm going to assign the program output, which is going to one of these inputs, and the input that it is 7. So I'm going to assign the input of 7 to the destination of 2. You know, I'm sorry that that's so confusing, but it is. So back to, I'm going to look at my destination 2 and see that it is actually right now input 11, which is cable TV, and I'm going to change it to program, I hope this works, which is 7. So I'm going to take my source and change it to 7, which is black, which very well may be the truth, and hit take. So I believe we've routed the program feed of this box to that screen. Now, let's look at our inputs. Why don't we route this TV, this television feed, to input 5 on the ATEM mixer? Okay, well, we know that input 5 is actually output 13 of the router. And what I'll do to make this make more sense is I'll post this somewhere so that you can see it, even if it's just typed out in the comments. I mean, sorry, not in the comments, but in the description of the video. So I'm going to look at, let's see, what did I say? Input, it's number 13 up here. So destination 13, I want to set the source of that to 11, which is this Sonic thing, and or this this cable TV, and it is set. All right. So what I should be able to do is look at what is, let's see. Let's look at input 5. We know that works. That's preview. That's program. If I choose 5, that should be there, but I'm not getting anything. All right. So, have I come to the part where I don't understand what to do? Maybe. let's see. Some of you are screaming at the screen. You know exactly. There I am. I'm in focus now. You know exactly what to tell me to do, and I just don't know yet. But this is part of the fun. I love to learn it. So let's be patient, and let me try a few things. Well, as of right now, I'm nowhere. But I've not looked at the manual, which normally I'm a manual kind of guy, but this is an unboxing video. I haven't looked at the manual, and I haven't tried to install any software. You think probably that's part of this problem, or at least I would get better results if I did that. So I'm going to stop the video for a sec. I'm going to move over to the software installation portion of all of this, and I'm going to go ahead and pull the software on the computer, not make you watch it install. If there's any snafus, I'll tell you about it. But once it's installed, then I'll start the video back up again, and we'll see how the computer communicating with the ATEM affects the situation. Okay? Give me a minute. We're not done yet. Okay, now I got a couple things to try. First, let's see if this preview monitor, when it comes on, shows our multi-view, because if it does, that might help us quite a lot. And then I've got the software ready to install, and the USB cable connected to the ATEM, so we have the ability to further troubleshoot using the software. So for now, let's just power on the preview monitor. Ah, we have, it says HDMI, it was 1080i60. And we've got our multi-view, and nothing is showing up, which, you know, we weren't getting anything on the ATEM screens or the router either. Now, I thought that I had camera 5. I thought I had that television source as camera 5. Now, it could be that we've got a problem as far as the resolution that we're expecting. I want my setup to be 1080p, actually. I'm not doing television broadcast. I don't have to turn in a program tape to a TV station or anything. So I think typically it's 1080i30 would be broadcast standard. I don't care about that. I'm going to be live streaming and recording for our own use. So I want it to be 1080p 30. So that's my plan. And then at some point we'll bump it on up to 4K. So, right now, that GoPro camera and the analog to SDI mini converter that I've got, I believe is set to be 1080p 30. And if that's the case, then that may be why we're not seeing these sources. So, let's go ahead and install the software and see what it tells us. Okay, well, it's installed, so let's run the software. Under Applications, I found it under Blackmagic ATEM Switchers, the folder. And then inside, it has the manual,
I'm glad it's got the manual. It has ATEM setup and ATEM software control. All right. Well, let's do setup first. Now, it did find it. It says ATEM 1ME Production Studio 4K. When I click, looks like that all I can do with this setup is, do you do that? My MacBook Pro, I touched the screen like I expected to do something. It seems like we're supposed to have a touch screen by now. Just saying, Apple, just saying that. Maybe we should have a touch screen by now because you got us touching our Mac screens constantly. Almost did it again. And all it gives us is the about box that shows what software version we're running and what it's titled, and then configure where I can set the IP address. So here's where we are. This the ATEM has an IP address of 192.168.10.240, subnet mask 255.255.255.0, and the default gateway of 192.168.10.1. I have duplicated that in my Thunderbolt Ethernet settings. I have a Ethernet Thunderbolt Ethernet adapter for my MacBook Pro. And so I went into the network, and for that Thunderbolt adapter, I changed it to configure itself manually, or for me to configure it manually. And I set up my IP address to be 192.168.10.200, so that it's within it's within that range. The first three numbers you want the same. The last number needs to be different. And then the subnet mask is the same as what is in the ATEM, the 255.255.255.0. And then the router I made the same as the gateway on the ATEM. So it says router here, gateway there. It's, I guess, the same thing. So I'm going to close this, open up the setup software, and see where we start. I'm sorry, the control software. And see if it detects it now. So, cancel that and close that. And we have a new icon here that is interesting. I'm going to click it. It's opening the software control, and there we are. It's working. Look at that. Isn't that so cool? Okay, I've replaced, instead of having the GoPro connected, I've scrapped that idea because I kept seeing online where people were having really a lot of trouble getting GoPros connected to the ATEM without a specific type of converter, and I don't have it, so forget it, I don't want to deal with it. I've got my GH4 that I'm looking at right now connected through USB to channel 1, so we're going to see how that works. Alright, so, but my suspicion is that this is not set at the same, frame rate, resolution, and so forth. The ATEM is not set to be 1080p30, because that's what I had set everything else to be. So, let's look and see. Down here in the bottom left, we have a sprocket, which usually means setup. And look, okay, it says set video standard, and it's set for 1080i 60, or 59.94. So 1080i, which is broadcast HD, that's what you would expect. But I have everything I'm doing, I want it to be 1080p30. So I'm going to change the standard to 1080p 2997 and hit set. Changing video standard will erase the frames in the media pool. Okay. We have picture. Yeah, can you see? I hope you can. It's in the... Oh, you can't see. Now you can see, but you can't see me. Ah. All right. Man, it's cramped in this room. I'm so sorry, guys. Now, I am going to tilt up just a hair. You're not going to be able to see everything. I've just got one prime lens, so I don't have zoom capability on this camera yet. All right, so I'm going to focus on the TV. Okay, so I'm going to be a little fuzzy, but everything here should be good. Let's see here. Okay, so let's explore this menu. We've got audio is set. Output is program audio. That's okay. I'm not sure about media pool, what that means yet. Camera, auxiliary for camera control output. Not right now. I don't know what that means. That's why I say not right now. Okay, here's our multi-view layout, and I like the layout. Let's see, but oh, they give us some options for layout. Oh, wow. That's neat. Okay, we'll leave it like this for now, but let's look under labels. Okay, this is what I was hoping I would find. So, so I've got cable TV, but I want to label it that. And you know, I've got this camera plugged into the HDMI port on the ATEM, and looks like this right here is where I'm going to be able to change it. So I'm going to switch from SDI to HDMI, and I'm going to change it to my GH4 so we know what it is. And on the label for the switcher, it's GH4. Okay. Nothing changed. Let me make this one here say cable TV. I'm going to hit save. Ha! Yes, we got it. Okay, so we've got the camera. Now I can look there and see myself. Hey, me. All right. So we've got two sources. We've got, looks like the camera one's on program. That's the GH4. And then cable TV. Excellent. This is what we wanted to see. I'm going to do my first crossfade between sources. Let's see. We've got the cable on preview. I'm going to click on auto trans. And it switched. And back. Looks pretty smooth. I don't want to look. I don't think we need to frame sync this. I think it looks pretty darn good. I'm pleased with this so far. I don't know. I mean, we've got two sources in, and really, they're two complicated sources. They're things that aren't normally 1080p 30. Now, I'll tell you one thing. Here's what I found in all of this troubleshooting. The analog to SDI converter by Blackmagic will convert to SDI, but it will not scale. So, like I've got it set up on this cable box. You know, it's not compatible natively. So I have a scaler, a little decimator scaler, in between, and that's what's getting it up to 1080p. So if you try this, make sure that not only are you converting your analog signal to SDI, but you're also scaling it to 1080p 30 or whatever you're choosing to set up your switcher to be. That's a problem. Also, now I guess the good thing is I can set my output on my GH4 to 1080p 30 or 29.97, and so I didn't have to scale that. But anyway, that just so if you're trying this at home the same exact way, I want you to know that that's probably your issue if you're not able to get cable. Because it has to be 1080p, 29.97 exactly for the ATEM to see it, apparently. And that's probably why the GoPro's not working. And I suspect, I don't know this, but I'm going to look and see that GoPro, it says on the front, 1080p 30, but I bet you it's not. I was assuming it's 1080p 29.97, but I bet it's exactly 30, and that might be the issue. That's a shot in the dark. I don't know. A little research might help. So that's all for today. I'm exhausted. This has been a tough one, but I feel like we've accomplished quite a lot, and I feel good about leaving it here. Walking across the parking lot, going to sleep, and tomorrow coming back and attacking a new project. I'm not going to try to do more with the ATEM yet. I think what I'll probably do is break out the HyperDeck and, you know, get that unboxed and that sort of thing. So look for a video soon about the HyperDeck 4K, and I'm thinking that'll be the next one. Whew, I'm tired. Well, until next time, I look forward to seeing you on another episode of Mr. Jamie on Campus.